Hello and welcome to Science Monitor, a show that brings to you the most significant news from the world of science, technology, innovation, research, discoveries, and much more. I'm Aishwarya, and here are this week's headlines. Dr. Harshvardhan inaugurates a wind augmentation and purifying unit or Vayu prototype device installed at ITO intersection and Mubarka Chowk in New Delhi. Scientists at the National Center for Radio Astrophysics in Pune successfully developed the design for the world's largest collaborative radio telescope project. Scientists at IIT Delhi develop unique low-cost polymeric knee joints for patients whose limb has been surgically removed. The Minister of Science and Technology announces India International Science Festival 2018 to be a tribute to former Prime Minister late Atal Bihari Vajpayee at a curtain raiser held in New Delhi. A top story this week. The Department of Science and Technology has supported the project Wind Augmentation and Purifying Unit or VAYU, an air pollution controlling device developed by the National Environmental Engineering Research Institute or NIRI in Nagpur with the aim to reduce pollution at traffic junctions. Dr. Harshvardhan, Minister for Science and Technology and Earth Sciences and Environment, Forest and Climate Change, inaugurated this device at ITO intersection and Mubarka Chowk in New Delhi. Science Monitor brings you a report on this latest initiative to curb the growing air pollution in cities across India.
Air pollution is increasingly becoming a cause of concern in Indian cities, and vehicular pollution has emerged as a major contributor in deteriorating the air quality. These automobile pollutants mainly constitute of particulate matter and poisonous gases like carbon monoxide, volatile organic compounds, and unburned hydrocarbons, which are released in the air in excessive quantities at busy intersections of the cities. In order to bring down the high level of pollution at traffic junctions in the country, CSIR's National Environmental Engineering Research Institute, or NEERI, has developed an air purifying device called VAYU, or the Wind Augmentation and Purifying Unit, to improve the air quality at urban intersections. Union Minister for Science and Technology, Earth Sciences, Environment, Forest and Climate Change, Dr. Harshvardhan, inaugurated the air pollution control device VAYU at ITO intersection and Mukarba Chowk in New Delhi on 25th September.
Aaj ek yahan par upkaran ko install kiya gaya hai. ये हमारी देश की जो प्रतिष्ठित संस्था CSIR है और उसी की जो सबसे प्रतिष्ठित वन ऑफ द मोस्ट प्रेस्टिजियस लेबोरेटरीज जो नीरी नागपुर है, नेशनल इंजीनियरिंग रिसर्च इंस्टीट्यूट जो है, इसकी नेशनल एनवायरनमेंट इंजीनियरिंग रिसर्च इंस्टीट्यूट, इसके द्वारा जो हमारा डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ साइंस टेक्नोलॉजी DST, जिसके सेक्रेटरी प्रोफेसर आशुतोष शर्मा मेरे दाईं तरफ बैठे हैं, उनकी ऐसी रिसर्चेस को प्रमोट करने के लिए, नई नई टेक्नोलॉजीज़ को डेवलप करने के लिए जो टेक्नोलॉजी डेवलपमेंट की स्कीम्स हैं, जिसमें हम सब देश में विभिन्न संस्थाओं को भी सहयोग करते हैं.
VAYU has been developed and integrated in such a way that it can work with solar power. This device works on two principles: wind generation for dilution of air pollutants and active pollutants removal. It has a fan and a filter for sucking and removing particulate matter and activated carbon, charcoal, and UV lamps for removing poisonous gases like volatile organic compounds and carbon monoxide. The air is oxidized inside the specially designed device, where carbon monoxide, hydrocarbons, and VOCs get converted to carbon dioxide. At the outlet of the device, the air has some residual velocity, and this velocity of air creates turbulence in the atmosphere, which helps in bringing down the pollutant concentrations by method of dispersion.
Initially, we started looking at this whole thing as a device which can be used in malls and some other locations where we have parking lots. in parking lots. You must have seen it's a very enclosed spaces. So we actually started designing for that, and then we realized that we need to augment this for a traffic junction. So the idea was, how do we deal with this traffic junction, which is the problem spots. We call it hot spots in that sense.
The indigenous device Vayu uses low-speed wind generators and appropriate size filters for long operation cycle with reasonable efficiency. It consumes only half a unit of electricity each day for running 10 hours and costs 60,000 rupees per device. The device aims at cutting down the concentration of pollutants by 40 to 60% within a diameter of 30 meter at high traffic zones. Vayu can prove to be a simple and cost-effective way to deal with vehicular pollution in the country.
Radio telescopes are an important tool in understanding our universe. Astronomers use this telescope to detect radio waves emitted by objects in the space like the sun, galaxies and stars. A team of scientists from 10 countries have now come together to make the world's largest square kilometer array, or the SKA telescope. When it is successfully built and made functional, it will help to map the space hundreds of times faster than the radio astronomy facilities available today. And for this, Indian scientists at the National Center for Radio Astrophysics in Pune, Maharashtra, have developed the Telescope Manager, which will control, monitor and operate the SKA telescope from Pune. Science Monitor brings to you this interesting report.
Our universe is vast, which is continuously expanding to form thousands of galaxies, planets and stars. The astronomers and space scientists seek to explore the infinite possibility of space with the help of different types of telescopes and satellites. A radio telescope is one such technology that gives a better view of planets, comets, solar winds, clouds of gas and dust, rotating stars and hidden galaxies. These heavenly bodies emit radio waves, which is the energy radiated by the object in the form of waves. Scientists study the radio waves originating from the sources to know their composition and motion of the space objects. Radio telescopes have an advantage as they can penetrate through sunlight, clouds, cosmic dust and clusters to reveal obscured areas of space. Now, a team of scientists and researchers from different countries have come together to build Square Kilometer Array, or SKA telescope, which will be the world's largest radio telescope. The countries for this collaborative project include Australia, Canada, China, France, India, Italy, New Zealand, South Africa, Spain, Sweden, the Netherlands and United Kingdom. SKA will use thousands of dishes and antennas that will enable astronomers to monitor the sky in depth and survey the entire sky much faster than any existing system. For this, Indian scientists at the National Center for Radio Astrophysics of the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research in Pune have contributed by successfully designing the telescope manager of the SKA project. Earlier, the team from the institute made the Giant Meter Wave Radio Telescope, or GMRT, near Pune. It is one of the largest radio telescopes working at low radio frequencies to provide insights of the outer space.
It is a global cooperation of 10 different countries all around the globe working together to design and build what will be a truly exceptional next generation radio astronomy facility, the Square Kilometer Array. It will be at least 30 times more powerful than our own Giant Meter Wave Radio Telescope.
SKA telescope is named so, as it is spread across 1 square kilometer, which equals about 100 hectares of land. The SKA telescope will use many low-frequency antennas and satellite dish technologies, which resemble TV dishes set on the top of a roof in houses. But first, let's see how a radio telescope works. It comprises of a large metal dish or wire mesh to reflect the radio waves to an antenna above the dish. The signal from antenna is sent to a power circuit to capture the faint signals. Then, these signals with the help of optical fibers are processed by a computer to form images of the universe. The dish surface area must be big. It is also beneficial in detecting weak cosmic radio signals effectively. Moreover, the large spread of the dishes helps to get high-resolution images of the radio waves. SKA is made of several parts like dishes, central signal processor, data signal processor systems, etc. The team led by Professor Yashwant Gupta from NCRA have made a telescope manager, which is the core part of SKA, and helps to monitor the entire telescope operations. Telescope manager is designed to perform a crucial task like information collection, scheduling observations, controlling their execution, monitoring the function of telescope parts, and fixing the faults.
The science goals that have been identified for the square kilometer array, and they cover areas which range from understanding the very early universe all the way to searching for signatures of life in the universe.
The telescope will be installed at two locations. One at South Africa's Karoo region to host high and mid-frequency dishes, and the second at Western Australia's Merseyside Shire region with low-frequency antennas. These two are the most important locations for direct radiation detection. The development of the world's largest radio telescope will open new avenues in making astronomical observations and to understand our mysterious universe in a better way.
It's time for a short break here, and when we'll come back, we'll see how scientists at Indian Institute of Technology, Delhi, have developed a low-cost and lightweight artificial knee joint. Keep watching Science Monitor.
I found that sexually transmitted infection was one which was very, very common. There was a big taboo with this. People would not come to clinicians to show for STI infections. Therefore, we started working on developing a kit for that. We are fortunate to get funding from Department of Biotechnology way back in 1999 when I joined here. And all my kits have been funding from DBT and then later on from BIRAC for doing field trials and clinical stuff.
Watch Eureka with Professor Daman Saluja, Director Dr. B.R. Ambedkar Center for Biomedical Research, Delhi University, Saturday 4 p.m, Sunday 12 noon, only on Rajya Sabha TV.
A prosthesis is an artificial device that replaces a body part which has been amputated as a result of accidental trauma, disease or congenital conditions. Loss of a limb can result in restricting movements and functional abilities of a patient. Prosthesis or an artificial body part can help patients regain their mobility. Thousands of people in India lose their limbs each year and have to undergo amputation. But many patients do not use artificial prosthetic limbs because of the material that they are made out of or the costs involved. Now a team of researchers from IIT Delhi have developed a low-cost and lightweight artificial knee joint, giving hope to many.
Locomotor's disability is a disability of bones, joint or muscles leading to substantial restriction of the movement of limbs. Around 1% of the population in India suffers from it. Out of them, almost 7.7% are transfemoral amputees. Transfemoral amputation is also known as above-knee amputation. It is a surgical procedure performed to remove the lower limb above the knee joint when that limb has been severely damaged due to accidents or disease or due to severe infection. In any case, prosthesis, an artificial device, is often suggested which allows the user to perform daily activities like walking, eating, and dressing independently and comfortably. Currently, prosthesis is being provided in India for transfemoral amputees with single-axis locking-type metal knee joint. This provides limited freedom during walking and requires more efforts due to locking knee, which causes discomfort for the patients and are also costly. Professor Naresh Bhatnagar and his research team at Indian Institute of Technology, Delhi, have focused on this issue and are now ready to provide a low-cost, lightweight and efficient prosthetic for lower limb amputees.
This particular knee design is a polycentric knee design with state-of-the-art injection molding technique for mass production. So the reason for going into mass production is that we can reduce the cost of this product so that it can be taken up by government or any other scheme of the government so that free of cost it can be given to people with disability. See, available knee joints are all metallic ones. So the weight will be a constraint and the cost of manufacturing that also will be high. It cannot be a low cost. Minimum cost which they can bring out will be somewhere around 5,000 to 10,000 rupees. Whereas this one can be easily sold by any dealer in 1,000 to 2,000 rupees.
Professor Naresh Bhatnagar started working on different types of designs for prostheses almost 10 years ago with two major objectives. First, the device should provide easy movement of knee as compared to commonly used knee joints which have certain limitations. Second, the cost as currently many prostheses available in the market made with different materials are quite expensive. As the cost of such ultra-modern prostheses are much higher and not affordable by all patients, Professor Bhatnagar and his team worked with dedication and their efforts paid off with the successful design and fabrication of India's first polymeric polycentric prosthetic knee joint. This polycentric knee joint allows easy bending and transfemoral amputation to walk comfortably with minimum difficulty in walking. Polycentric prosthetic knee joint has been tested clinically at Department of Physical Medicine and Rehabilitation, Government Medical College, Thiruvananthapuram. And the results showed that the patient using these new prosthetics walked close to natural walking pattern as compared to the conventional ones. This unique design and fabrication of polymeric polycentric prosthetic knee joint done by Professor Bhatnagar and his team will surely help the differently abled. The product is ready and it can be used for mass production.
The fourth edition of the India International Science Festival or IISF will be inaugurated by President of India in Lucknow on 6th of October this year. At the curtain raiser in New Delhi, Science and Technology Minister Dr. Harshvardhan stated that the IISF is the largest platform in the country which brings together students, scientists, innovators, artists and the general public to celebrate India's achievements in science and technology. The current edition of the festival is a tribute to former Prime Minister, late Atal Bihari Vajpayee. IISF is also a medium to encourage young minds towards the field of science and to promote the networking of stakeholders who are dedicated to the myriad fields of science and technology. Science Monitor brings you a report.
Over the years, science and technology in India has achieved tremendous growth and has brought the country to the forefront of conducting mega researches and devising new technologies. Be it in space, medical or communication, India has come a long way to acknowledge the need of development. For achieving several milestones in the field of science and technology, it requires time, effort and dedication. To celebrate this success and to instill the young minds with scientific temperament, every year, India International Science Festival or IISF is organized with an aim to spread the importance of science and its significant role in solving societal problems. The platform brings together students, researchers, artists and general public to celebrate the nation's achievements in science and technology. IISF 2018 is organized by Ministry of Science and Technology, Ministry of Earth Sciences in association with Vijnan Bharati or Vibha from 5th to 8th October 2018 in Lucknow. The theme for this year's Mega Science event is Science for Transformation. The fourth edition will be inaugurated by the Honorable President of India, Ram Nath Kovind. Recently, a curtain raiser ceremony of the festival was held in New Delhi on 24th September. Here, Dr. Harshvardhan, Minister of Science and Technology, Earth Sciences, Environment, Forest and Climate Change, and Professor Ashutosh Sharma, Secretary, Department of Science and Technology, addressed a gathering of 150 participants of scientists and research scholars.
This festival is a great example of how to bring science out from the labs and connect to people, connect to the larger concerns of science, connect with the society at large. It is not something we can get in classrooms. It is not something we can get simply by talking to a few scientists. So this is really indeed the Mahakumbh of science.
This year, the largest science gathering of the country will witness 23 special events with 10,000 delegates from India and around the world. Some of the major highlights will be Global Indian Science and Technology Stakeholders Meet, Clean Air Campaign, Young Scientists Conference, National Science Teachers Congress, Science and Technology for Harnessing Innovations, and Student Science Village, Reaching the Unreached. IISF 2018 will also showcase outstanding contributions made by Indian innovators in the field of science, technology, and industry. The role of women scientists and entrepreneurs in building scientific community will also be a major feature of the four-day festival.
This bar, हम दो गिनीज बुक ऑफ वर्ल्ड रिकॉर्ड के अंदर दो प्राइजेस को एम करने का प्रयास कर रहे हैं. एक में जो बच्चे हैं वो डीएनए को सेपरेट करने के अपने एक्सपेरिमेंट के अंदर गिनीज बुक ऑफ वर्ल्ड रिकॉर्ड में नाम दर्ज कराने का प्रयास करेंगे, और एक बच्चों को फर्स्ट एड की ट्रेनिंग देने के मसले पर गिनीज बुक ऑफ वर्ल्ड रिकॉर्ड के अंदर हम रिकॉर्ड बनाए.
This is just a glimpse. The biggest science festival of the country is packed with many more events, talks, activities and films waiting to be explored from world of science. So do participate in this extravaganza to learn and understand the different aspects of science which connects us all.
It's time for a short break, and when we come back, we will bring you some more news on science and innovation from India and around the world. So stay tuned. But first up, a closer look at the second global RE Invest.
All stakeholders, including those in the development of solar power, those in the manufacturing of solar power, those in financing, those in research, academics, they'll be coming together, both from the country and from the entire world.
The Union Cabinet has approved a comprehensive policy to deal with excess sugar production in the country.
That sugar cane growers, they are not able to get their payment not only in time, there is a huge kind of arrears for some time, for 2 years, 3 years, there will be no payment to them. And in order to meet this kind of challenge, I think the sugar mills need some kind of assistance.
It is a very good step, a very timely step to ensure that the excess stocks with the mills are exported outside, money comes back, and with that the farmers are paid their arrears.
Welcome back after the break, and now let's take a quick look at some more scientific innovations and developments from India and around the world.
Japan Aerospace Exploration Agency has successfully landed Minerva 2-1, or micro-nano experimental robot vehicle for asteroid, on an asteroid surface on 21st of September. The robot rover is the world's first man-made object designed to explore asteroids. The Minerva 2-1, with two of its rovers, Rover 1A and Rover 1B, was sent to board Hayabusa 2 spacecraft. The rovers will move around the asteroid surface to take pictures and collect data for the study. In a recent development, two organizations, the Nature Conservation Foundation and Conservation India, have come together to start a citizen science initiative for the conservation of hornbill birds. The initiative will help to collect the data of these birds in order to understand their habitat and presence in India. This unique initiative will help to protect their surrounding and will highlight the possible threats faced by these species. For more information, check website www.hornbills.in. The Ministry of New and Renewable Energy under the Government of India organized a curtain raiser on 25th September for the second global Reinvest India International Solar Alliance Partnership Renewable Energy Investors Meet and Expo, which will be held from 3rd to 5th October 2018 at the India Expo Center, Greater Noida. The second global Reinvest will host the first assembly of International Solar Alliance and the meeting of the energy ministers of Indian Ocean Rim Association countries. Reinvest is a global platform to explore strategies for development and deployment of renewables. It showcases India's clean energy market and the government's efforts to scale up capacity to meet the national energy demand in society, economically and ecologically sustainable ways. India today is the world's largest clean energy market, with exponentially increasing demand and supply and proactive policy support. The Council of Scientific and Industrial Research, or CSIR, celebrated its 77th Foundation Day on 26 September. On this occasion, CSIR awarded scientists for their contribution in the field of life sciences, physical sciences, including engineering, innovation, business development, and technology marketing. Dr. Aishwarya, Minister of Science and Technology, Environment, Forest and Climate Change, and Professor Ashutosh Sharma, Secretary, Department of Science and Technology, graced the occasion with their presence. The Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Prizes for 2018 were also announced at the event.
And in the history of science, this week we remember Indian physicist and meteorologist Pisharoth Rama Pisharoti. He was born on 10th of February 1909 in Kerala. His main area of study was monsoon meteorology and climate. He played a significant role in the setting up of the remote sensing technology in India. From 1972 to 1975, he was the director of remote sensing and satellite meteorology at ISRO Space Applications Center in Ahmedabad. For his valuable contributions, he is regarded as the father of Indian remote sensing. He won many prestigious awards like the Padma Shri in 1970, Raman Centenary Medal in 1988, and International Meteorological Prize in 1989. He passed away on 24th of September 2002 at the age of 93 in Pune. His significant contribution in the field of remote sensing technology continues to be of great significance for scientists and researchers even today. And that's it in this edition of Science Monitor. You can send your feedback and suggestions to Science Monitor on our email ID news@vigyanprasar.gov.in. You can also write into us at Vigyan Prasar, C24, Khutub Institutional Area, New Delhi 110016. We'll see you again next week with another episode of Science News and Innovations. Till then, goodbye and take care.